radio back in the shop. And we now have two jets. We have number 01, which is the original one, that has been out to Bill Hummel. He's run it. Dub made up a new head for it, and we'll still have the original head. Dub also made up a smaller Venturi, a 156. So the way this test program is going to go now, this motor, of course, is going out to Bill Hummel for testing in his plane. We have our test plane set up for our engine. This is number 105. And this one is a little, the changes are, it's got a different head on it, a different Venturi, and the clearances up top are just a little bit tighter. Oh, I just love looking at these motors. Anyway, but the nice thing is we have two of them also, so that we can start narrowing down which of the setups we like the best, and of course pass the information on to Dub as we go along. That's coming. Later tomorrow we have another one of our now being fine-tuned radial engine cowlings. That's one of the projects we've been working on, just to set the stage here a minute. Now, you can see it's night already. We've been working every day late. What I did with this is I've got, this is going to be the fifth coat, and I'll do this off camera. I got five coats before I go to bed. Five coats of clear on this wood. What I want to do is harden up the wood just so that what'll happen is the wood will be a little bit harder than the little glue seams around it. And I'll do a little fine sanding on it before that's ready to be tissued. Also got this, we got the Jet 60, the George Aldrich special here, the special custom 60 that he made me just before he passed away. That's in a plane ready to test. We also have the Webers here. Bob Zambelli's in the process of making up some real light tongue mufflers. In the meantime, we're just going to run dry to get some time on these motors. We got them hanging up here like it's a laundry machine. These little guys look like they have a lot of promise. The Jets look like they have a lot of promise. And boy, oh boy, are we excited about getting the back of the nacelles made, maybe the flaps, whatever is going to be in the next couple of days. The project is really starting to come together. Every time I come out here and just look at it, the gear blocks are in. The tank boxes are in. Everything's fuel-proofed. And it's so late that it's time to go to bed. Working past midnight here every day. Now, the first thing I like to do this morning, before I get started on the actual airframe itself, we have another cowling, and I've been making these up pretty much every day. The idea being I want to fine-tune the material. Now, whenever you make a cowling for the first time, or any composite part, you need to know how much material you want to, how thick do you want to make it, how much is it allowed to weigh. In this case, what I'm looking for is somewhere around an ounce. The first one was way over an ounce. So what I did is I thinned out the material on the ones after that. And I'm getting it down to where this one is possibly a little bit too thin. But that's how you know where too thin is. If you didn't do that, I don't think you could ever get it as good as if you're willing to just make part after part. And in this case, and I'm going to explain real soon what the problem really has become with this, with the weight. And it's not an unmanageable thing, but it's something we certainly have to deal with. Now, anytime you're pulling a mold like this apart, it's always good to pull it back little by little. Don't just try to rip it out. Even though this is carbon fiber, this is relatively delicate. And like I said, every once in a while, you just gotta fool around here a little bit to get this out. Because we have that bottom lip that kind of holds it in place. There we go. And if I can get these parts down to about an ounce, I'm thinking that's going to be about the limit. Of course, if you make it much lighter than that, then the problem's going to be they're going to break. Here it comes now. A lot of people think you just go like this and it falls out. No, then not really. That's why I always leave plenty of material on here so I can hold it. All right. Now this looks like we're close. I don't know what this weighs yet. We'll get on here. I put a lot of the little, the filler, rather than load the whole edge up with carbon fiber. Get some idea. Once I trim this back, what it's going to weigh, I'm sure we're somewhere near the acceptable limit. Now it's a question of just fine-tuning this. Now we finally, after a long time, got the cowlings down to an ounce. This is 28, it's exactly an ounce. And that's where I think any thinner than that, and it's going to be, they're going to have cracks and things in them. Put it off camera, but we're going to try to even make one of these even a little bit lighter. I'm going to try to use a little bit different material. But that's the fun of doing this. And let me explain why I'm so caught up in getting the weight on all these component parts down. It's important to know. Now, to understand why I've been so crazy about trying to keep the weight down, we originally started the model, and the first thing we had to decide was how big is this model going to be in, because Dave Downey has a CAD-CAM program, he can enlarge or shrink the model appropriately. We originally started out, it was going to be a 900-inch model, and what happened, I made a little prototype out of cardboard. I just cut the 900-inch plans up from a refrigerator box, and here's what happened. It didn't fit in my car anyway. There's no way I could transport this. And when I approached Karen with the idea, hey, it's time to trade in the car and buy a motorhome, well, needless to say, she got the last word on that. So we decided to make the model 800 inches. Now, the miscalculation on my part was, if we had an 800-inch model, we'd be not so concerned. Well, I'd still be concerned, but not paranoid like I am now. Let me explain why. Now, if we had an 800-inch Miss Ashley, just as an example, the wing area that we don't generally use, or that serves very little purpose in my book anyway, the tips, almost always, even though people calculate them into the square area, they don't serve any useful purpose. So what happens is this is the effective, or aerodynamically people call it the wet area. Well, we started out with 800 inches and that would have been fine, and I assumed that it was my miscalculation that once you deduct for the fuselage and the wing tips and things like that, we'd come out about 700. Well, what's happened is, and I never took into the calculation, our body is almost double. So what happens, it blanks out a giant part of the wing, and I never, and I don't know how I did this, it's my own fault, I never calculated out that the nacelles are blocking this out. And what happened, Dave Downey did a real accurate calculation, and with all of this taken away, we don't have 700, we have 630 square inches of wet, useful wing area. Well, you can see the calculation changes now. Where I originally started out with an 800.9, I figured the model at best could be 72 ounces. That would be what I'd be shooting for. Well, this I could kind of deal with the fact that this could be 63. There's no way this model's going to be 63, by the way. But now it's not like we're fighting for that last little bit of proof. We're fighting for survival. Because with 630 inches, yeah, we're looking at a model that has to realistically be somewhere in the high, let's give it the benefit of the doubt, 58. And there is absolutely no way. 58 is out of the question. That's not achievable even in a Miss Ashley, almost, unless you make all carbon fiber parts. So, rather than giving up, I came up with a couple of solutions. Well, I didn't. Dave Downey did. Dave and I both came up with these solutions. Because we already have the wing built, there's a couple of things that we've decided to do. What we're going to do is, Dave came up with all new drawings for the nacelles that show this extended. And we're going to extend, and my original thought was we should make this was about 3.8, we should go to 4.5, just make bigger flaps. So that any time, you get two things, you get more lift and a little more area, maybe we can get that up to 650. But even so, this is really a pull out all the stops measure. And I think the reality is, that even 650 is not going to be really, really doable at this point unless we start drilling holes and everything. The other problem is the plane has asymmetrical tips, which we don't count the tips, but they will have, there's more lift on the top than on the bottom, and the nacelles are smaller on the top and bottom. Now keep in mind, what's the answer? Yeah, the answer is build an Obler and you don't have these problems, but then it wouldn't be semis, then it wouldn't be the B-25. And that, it wouldn't be the challenge that it is. So we're going to calculate out this piece of the back longer than what it's drawn so that we have the ability to make bigger flaps. Now what I'm going to do is the original flaps, I'm going to make the original flaps that are going to go on a plane this bigger size, but I'll have the ability, of course, because the flaps will always be removable, that I can go to smaller flaps. And if the plane turns out, and I'm hoping that this is not the case, to really be needing that wing area, over the winter next year, I can cut the wing tips off, carve a piece of wing, so that in essence I can pick up some area here. But by now, I'll already know how much the model weighs. And let's say the model weighs 72 ounces. I'll know how big I have to make this wing, how big I have to extend it. This is final stopgap, temporary stopgap, and I'll always have the ability to make the standard size flaps. So that's the reason, and I only wanted to lay that out, why I'm making myself crazy with making cowl after cowl, trying to get them super light, drilling holes in things. Bob Zambelli is trying to make me up some super light tongue mufflers. There's really going to be no extra fat on this plane from this point on to even come close to that weight that we're looking for. And without that weight, it's going to be a very disappointing first flight, I know that. I would another cowl in the mold. I've had this dry and I have 5 coats of Brodak clear. The reason is, this is the only part of the model that's going to be planked, and it hardens up the wood, and now I'm able to block sand out any other little imperfections, and I'm going to leave the gear blocks right in place. Block sand this out with maybe some 320. I really want to be, this is the only part of the model that has a planking where there's a lot of glue joints, and so by hardening up the wood, I think I can get the glue joints to be a lot less obvious in the final product here. What this allows me to do now that I couldn't do before, the joints are relatively hard. The wood is as hard as the joints now. Not as hard, but close to being as hard. And I can just, all I'm going to do is carefully pick up all the high spots. And I can feel very careful. Otherwise, what's going to happen? They're going to come up through the silt span. I also want to get just a little bit down in here with my little, I don't know what you want to call it, the little polywog tool, and start working my way into that fillet each time I put some material on there. I really like the way the planking came out. One of the parts of the model I'm real satisfied with, and I've already talked to Elliot Scott about maybe even in the future coming up with some kind of 30s air racer ship with a round fuselage. I think Dan Bandrock, again, he's already done that this year, so maybe we'll have to put that off for a couple of years. So I'm going to go over the whole nacelle area, and then I'm going to be ready to, the next thing is going to be to measure up and carve this back block. That'll be the back part of the nacelle. Now, because I'm working these edges in with sandpaper, I can see that I could benefit a little bit by just getting a little bit of Brodak primer right in the joint. Because this can dry overnight, of course, and I can sand it out. And this'll give me a little bit better look at what the high spots are, and there's one right here, of course. And filling in these little gaps with Brodak primer is going to be a lot lighter than whatever the alternative would be. And I want really clearly defined fillet areas here. Now, can you imagine? I'm just thinking of things. Can you imagine if the wing was in raw wood right now and you were grinding in and making ditches and stuff there? But whatever it takes to get the wing in silver first on a project like this, right now you're saving 10 times that amount of time. And I'm trying to come up with another number. Had a couple people ask me, how much time am I spending on this plane relative to a Cardinal or a Miss Ashley? Right now, I guess about, conservatively, about six times. You could make six regular stunt ships by the time you could come up with. Basically, because we're doing engines and inventing these formulas and, but whatever challenge there's been, and there's certainly been a lot, having the team that I have to rely on of Dave Downey and Tom and Elliot, it's going to make this project as good as it ever possibly can be, because I really feel in my heart this is one of the most scale planes. I'm not sure if we're going to be able to make that weight limit, but boy, if we do, is it going to be fun. Now what that'll do, that once that dries up, because I'm going to work on the other nacelle, I can get both edges. When that's dry, I can just get in there with my little block, with the point, and little by little start to feel where that contour is. Now here's another little thing right here, a little gouge I guess I stuck the sandpaper in. And I always prefer doing a touch-up as I go rather than waiting and trying to do it all at once at the end of the project when you're in such a rush to fly and you finish the plane and it just never seems to work out as well. Now this is the latest drawing we have from Dave Downey. We also have one that supersedes this, that has the cowls extended as a separate drawing. I'm going to work off that one. Again, because we're going to extend the flaps some, and we don't know exactly how much, I want to extend the nacelles the equivalent amount, so we keep the same proportion in the back. Now, so from this, we can calculate out the amount we're going to extend the flaps and just interpolate this. In other words, just extend it and get the curve to blend relatively close. Now I have the pattern from which shows that even has a wing. And you can see we've got that pretty accurate. We've got that, in fact, real accurate. So I can work right off of this template. I can work right off this. This is going to be one side of this. Now I need to measure this because I'm sure this is more than an inch, which means I was going to try to use almost 2 inches. Forget it. I'm going to have to make this in several pieces. Can't even make it in 2 1-inch pieces. If I had 2-inch, I can't even make it in 2 1. Actually, I'm going to look and see if I have any 2-inch wood. If I don't, laying this out in relatively several pieces, maybe. I don't know. In my supply of blocks, I came across this one that's from a 5.3 block. The only problem is I don't think it's long enough. I've already had pieces taken off of this. This is one of the ones we use to make Cardinal cowls. And of course it's plenty big, so by laminating up two of these, in fact, you know what, I'm not even going to be able to laminate two of these. Every part of this is bigger than it has to be, bigger than I'm able to make it with these giant trucks. So it may be that the easiest way here is going to be to make slices going this way and just live with the fact that we have a lot of joints. I'm not sure. Laying this out is going to be a little more complicated than I originally thought. This is when you have something unusual like this. It's not the usual 1-inch top block, inch and a half. Everything is a little bit more complicated. Now it's apparent that I'm going to have to put joints all over the place here, but in fact, I'm even going to need a joint on the bottom. I want to lay this out in 1-inch wood. I'm going to need, am I going to need 4? Yeah, I'm going to need 4. There's no way 3 are going to do it. Not even close. So I guess I may as well quit fooling around and get all these blocks cut up. I'm going to actually need a piece on the bottom because this is more than 4 inches, just a little bit in this dimension. But I have a good template for this. Now I'm wondering, should I make it? No, I should make it in 4 pieces and have it separate in the middle because I need to get in there and hollow it out. So rather than fool around, let me just cut up. I'll do one side totally first before I cut up the wood. A lot of thinking around and dinking around. I made the blocks oversized, and I made two permanent joints. Each one of these is a permanent joint. That won't come apart. Because what I'll do when I'm done carving it is split it on the center seam. And I just thought, even though there's a lot more work getting it carved this way, I know I can get the last little bit of material out. When I hollow it, it'll be relatively thin. Now, it's not big enough. I still have to, after I do this rough carving, I'm going to have to make a piece. I don't know how big that's going to be. But I can start working right now by just tack joining these together. The first step is just slightly tack joining them. Because that, again, that's going to come apart. The piece, it's got a temporary joint here, a permanent joint here. I'm going to leave the bottom piece till just a little bit later. I want to trace out my, and carefully get, now notice Dave has a nice center line on there. Good, and leave this maybe a 16th of an inch bigger than it has to be, so it'll last a little bit. Once this is tack glued in place, I can true that in. From six different angles, we have roughly the front view, and I did that with the template. I'm going to leave myself, like I said, about a 16th. I did the top view, and I did the interpolation, so we have a little extra material. And now, basically, the bottom, I'll just figure where that little piece is going to go when I'm done. I'm not going to worry about that right now. Now it's just a question of, like anything else, a brand new blade, a brand new number 26 blade, and start carving away. And this is the part that, well, it's not really intimidating, and I'm looking at this from a lot of different, I probably could get some of this off with the saw. So now we have a big chunk of that at least lopped off. Now I can start in the corners. And again, there's nothing here except just, I know a job like this is not going to take a half an hour, so I try to spread it out. Start with, taking the biggest areas, of course, off and working my way down. And then when I get to a point where I can fit it, I want to fit it in place, tack glue it, get the final contours in, break it off, take it apart, and hollow it. Which would be no different than any other block, except this is just a lot wider. It's going to be labor-intensive, and whenever you have a long trip, I treat it like a long trip, like a long carving job, just going to get myself comfortable. Make sure I have an empty garbage can for the chips and start carving away. That is no substitute at all for just having a brand new blade. And in this case, what I want to try to do is work. In other words, I know this material here has to go. A lot of times when I'm doing a carving job, I wonder, I honestly don't know, or I would try to put it on video, of course, exactly how I arrive at where do you start removing material and how do you, what goes with the horse in front of the cart, but I know a lot of times if you just do it, in this case, I want to get one quadrant kind of, and then go to the other side and work the other quadrant. I know one thing with carving, you can't rush it. The minute you start trying to take big giant chunks out, you're really at a disadvantage. The advantage is to just work slow, whether it's a cowl, a wingtip, or in this case a nacelle. But sooner or later we're going to arrive at, and I won't put the whole thing on video of course, or we're going to be bored to death. Sometime I get bored just doing this. usually right about now when Chickadooley gets over here and starts stealing these pieces of chips, and they all wind up, half of them wind up on a floor or in his cage or something. But I think you can get the general idea that we're just going to start working toward that contour, and we're going to start roughly just evaluating that where that would kind of blend. And then I can look at the patterns that Dave has. I can make negative patterns and just see if I'm a little too fat, too skinny, too what.
And so here we have the first half just roughed out. And I've left enough oversize that I'll be able to, once this is tacked in place, get that last little bit off. Now the next thing is try using this as a kind of a guide for my hand, work this side down.
Now we've roughed it down almost to the last line, and I don't want to go too far, of course. Now what I need to do, this is significant. Because I have a joint in the center, I'm working toward the center line, it's easy to keep things relatively symmetrical. The problem is I'm following the trailing edge of the wing, so what's happening now, this is canted out. So I need to adjust this angle up here just a little bit. So the next thing I want to do is just figure out roughly how much pen. Go over to the belt sander and make a little adjustment here. And this needs to go about that much. So what I can do is just get this belt sanded down so that this goes right up in place without being off to one side. Now I have that surface nice and flat and roughly the right angle. Now I need to just make a little point here where the wing, actually the center line of this wing, intercepts this right about there. So now if I connect the wing, I need to make a center line on this and just roughly, and this is not a real accurate thing right now, I need to cut out the piece of the wing a little half moon there so this can plug right onto the back of the nacelle. Now this will just allow me, and I'll work off these lines, just get a Dremel bit in there and just hog that out for now, because I need to be able to plug this right up on the back of the wing. And I can follow this center line right through the motor mount, right through the nacelle. I need to get this tacked in position as one of the next steps. You can see what I'm trying to do is make that cut. I could also, as a final thing, because I have that little half moon in there, take a little piece of copper or aluminum tubing with sandpaper and get a nice notch. But because this is all going to be hollow, all I really care about is this little edge here. Now I want to make a nice butt joint on here, but it's going to be difficult because this whole surface is canted off to one side by just a bit. So what I want to do is I want to just remove just a little bit of material in the front here. In fact, the other choice I have, I could make a spacer. Now this material is going to get removed anyway, but by taking off say eighth of an inch, quarter of an inch, instead of having two flat surfaces that have to meet, and if there's one little spot where they're not sitting, it'll do this. I'll have two where it'll be touching on the edges, and I can get a final adjustment on it a lot easier than two surfaces. Anytime you want to get two surfaces that join real nice, you want them to just join on the edges, and then we could just chamfer one edge. Otherwise, we're going to be on a belt sand that this piece is going to be an inch shorter by the time we're done. And I just have to allow here the eighth of an inch wire for the when the horn goes through there. I don't need to take any more than this off, but I just need to get this whole core taken out. And of course, it's with a carbide tip jet, just goes right out. We could just kind of erase it. Again, the purpose of this whole thing is so that I can get edges, joining edges. I don't want two flat surfaces because I need to get my center line lined up, and I want it to be exactly right on the money. And if I take that much material off the whole part, that should be enough. I need to take a little bit of this off. Just a little bit, just to get that fit. This slides right up in place. Now this is tack glued in place. Just tack glued roughly, and the next step is I want to make a little block that's just going to just get tacked in that. I don't have a perfect joint here. There's still going to be a little shim, but when this part is all carved, then I can just keep touching, because it'll be paper thin then. I can have that last little bit. It's difficult to fit two flat surfaces. Any little spot that's off is a problem. But with this just roughly in shape now, and it's plenty oversized, now I can work actually right from the nacelle and start carving and sanding that in. Now it's just, I'm trying to lay the knife right on the part. It's another reason why it's nice to have this relatively hard balsa now, because it's got a little bit of the coats of dope that we put on there. Now any little gap in here, needless to say, we can fill this in after we get this car. The next step is to just fine tune this, get this both block sanded and fine tuned in. And then from Dave's drawing, make a little template to see that we have this curve right. Again, this part, very delicate and time consuming. Don't want to rush it. I want to get right in here. I don't want to get all of a sudden where I have to chunk, I have to fill. Because we can't really permanently install this until we have our horn arrangement worked out. And we still don't know exactly how we're going to do that. We haven't made a final decision yet. It's always best to work with your hand, not with your eye. Your hand will always find your hard spot or rough spot. Luckily, we have this center line to kind of work off as a reference to. One area I'm finding to be a lot more challenging than I thought it would be is maintaining this contour this whole thing in a nacelles. You could easily build a whole stunt plane in what it takes to do nacelles. But the look is very close to what I think ultimately will be a very, very scale plane. And this allows us the option of having the bigger and the smaller flaps. I just try to pick up the high spots. I need to make up that little block here too. You can see how much just getting this contour blended in is is not a 5-minute job, that's for sure.
Thing's going to be that little block. And I'll just tack that in place because that, again, that's going to have to come off and get hollowed also. Now again, I'll just shape that the same way. So, and when this all comes apart, every one of these pieces is going to have to be hollowed out, of course.
Have enough labor-intensive stuff. This has turned out to be, and again, it's not hollowed out, so I'm trying to leave just a fraction of material extra here. Just trying to blend in all the areas and keep the contours as close to Dave's drawing as possible. This is the contour you're really going to see. This can't be off even by just a little bit. It's unbelievable how long I've been sanding and feeling. But I think I've got pretty much, I've got this contour right, I've got this contour right, I've got the top contour. And this actually does become an oval toward the back. So I'm really, really happy with the way. This was so labor intensive, I'm telling you. And I want to get one or two more little swipes of the paper here. And then I'm going to pull this part off and hollow it out. Because that last little bit that I need to put on, the last little bit of sanding, I don't want to do now. Once we glue this, it resets at another spot. But all the contours, and it's really a thing of beauty when it's done. Again, the beauty of it is that we've worked from really accurate drawings without those. Without Dave Downey's drawings, if I did this by eyeball, forget about it. This little block blended in nicely. Now I'm trying not to get the, you know, lose the contour. The contour is so important here. And the way to check a contour is just by bare hands. You'll feel it right here. I can feel, in fact, yeah, Wendy, you missed a spot right here. And to sand in this dimension, not back and forth, because you're making flats then. We want that to butt right up on the plank part. Now I'll look at the books when I get the final little sanding in and see just how much of a radius or angle that is in the back. But I think we've got it. And there's one thing about having a really challenging job like this that's relatively labor intensive. What happens when you're done with it, you go, yes. You get a real feeling of satisfaction. Because the truth is, not many people in the world of stunt can even appreciate what a job like this entails, or let alone that they would ever want to do it. But those few people that do. Oh, that's, see that? Right in here, there may be a little spot that I'm fudging, but right here, where, and that's what I was concerned with, where the planking ends, and where the block begins, right there. I think I've got it. Now, I don't even need to smooth sand it out, because when I get it in, then I'll do that final sanding with some 320 or 400 or whatever. But that was, you're looking at a lot of labor. I'm not even going to start to figure out. I'll just set aside a whole day tomorrow or the next day and do the other one. This one is, in every way that you can rub your hand on that, that just feels like really, really. Got to give Dave Downey credit for that. That really worked out nice. And we're already starting to, in the emails Dave and I are doing, is starting to discuss how we're going to lay out the flaps. It looks like it's going to be, now that the nacelle is in place, this little flap that's about the size of a postage stamp, as soon as you would put it down, it would hit the side of the nacelle. So we're going to try to engineer up something a little different out here, and that's what I'll be thinking about tonight.
Now the next thing, of course, is to just get a brand new blade in there, pop that apart. Pop the center apart and turn it into two clamshells, hollow it out as much as possible. That really, it has a very, very, to me, realistic look to it anyway. like this, and I come back to this, from how many hours I put into getting this contour really nice, that I was happy with it, but now that's a focal point of the plane. That just how that blend comes in, many of the little curves and angles and things, when you get a curve that's just perfect, the amount of time you spend, it really seems worth it. It's one of the focal points of the model.
I'm always real careful about digging my way through here. A new blade is good. Sometimes a razor will just do this a little bit better. Again, since we're going to glue this right back, once we get the wire for the horn in, it's true though, nacelles are, boy, don't even think about something this intensive unless you have your wallet handy. Okay. Now we can estimate the wall thickness here, and just, I'm gonna pop this apart. This is the temporary seam.
I wanna leave these little chunks in place because they'll interface, interlock into where we cut this apart. I want to allow myself, before I split this apart, and this I will do carefully because we're trying to get, as I try to explain before, get every little bit of weight out of this. Now, we have discussed many times how big we're going to make the flaps. Dave and I have come to a mutual agreement on this, of how we're going to at least give us a little better chance of the flaps go from 80 square inches to 91 inches, so that brings me up to, I don't know, not something I'm real happy with, but something I certainly think is a little bit more realistic than 630. Now that's getting hollowed out anyway. I'm a little bit off here, and I'm off because of the angle of the trailing edge sweeps forward, and I've tried to keep these in 90 degree alignment. So one is just a little bit different than the other. Then I'll do the same thing here, give myself about an eighth of an inch. We have that little piece. In fact, I'm going to leave a little bit at the end because what's going to happen if I don't, that's going to be just get a little bit too thin out there, and somebody will bump it while they're launching a plane or changing a glow plug or something. And then my little piece here, which is going to go on the bottom. Better leave a little extra material on this. And this piece here, that's getting carved away, so this can go right away. And we're ready to hollow this out. I like to get some of these aren't really sharp anymore. Time to get some blades here. This is about to get us more. The reason I like to get as much out with the gouge as possible, because I don't like to make dust in the shop, or all our HEPA filters in the house, and we have HEPA filters all over the place because of Karen's allergies. They clog up right away with sawdust, and then you've got to go buy more filters. So I try to do as much with the carving as I possibly can. And the final thing, I'll go over by the Dremel tool there and get the last little bit out. But we want to get as much of this hollowed out as we can. Carving as I can done here. In fact, I got a little bit of tension when the, yeah, I got a spot here. Now, what I wanted to show, I guess the reason I jumped it, whenever you have a joint in a block and you're hollowing it, well, what happens is there's spots you may not have a totally good glue seam. And as I'm hollowing here, I could see this open up. So I went in and got this re-seamed with thin CA. Hopefully we don't want to have a problem with that. But I really do want to spend the time getting from this point in the model on, every possible thing that I can get rid of on this model. See, now this is where it really pays to have friends like Bob Zambelli or people that can do these difficult to do things like making up some real ultralight mufflers. We're still going to be making cowlings until I get one under an ounce. I want one. I'm going to set some unrealistic goal here, but now I'm going to get this shape here is good for hollowing because you can move. See what you do? You put the sandpaper there. You're constantly wearing out the tip of the sandpaper. And now I just want to sand and get out all of the carving marks, if I can, until I have the equivalent of a clamshell. And of course, I got to do the two big pieces and one little one. You can see how quickly this... Now, as soon as that edge of sandpaper wears out, we just move it down for the next little notch. Spend another 15-20 minutes getting this just to where it's just as smooth on the inside as the outside, and that the wall thickness is even. That it's not
okay. It's about as thin wall as I dare make it. Nicely dressed off, and I'm going to do the other two parts off camera. Well, that's going to be the end of what I'm going to be able to get done tonight. Is just get these all hollowed out. These working past midnights, Karen is getting a little annoyed, so I don't want to push too much. I've been pushing since the minute I started this project, but maybe at some point in time it just gets where you need a rest. And if I get this done tonight, I'll take a rest, believe me. Need a day at the flying field is what we need. Now, after getting these nice and thin, all three of them are nice. A little recess for the horn. Now the last step I'm going to do tonight, and I am going to pack it in here, join them all together so that I'll have a plug that I can, I'm going to do the other one, of course, but I'll be thinking about how I want to route this. Don't forget, I need a horn that goes through here, comes up to the joint in the ring here. I need to make, well, that's all for another day, brainstorming for another day. But these pieces, I thought this was quite a job getting this done in one day. Pretty impressive. Even I'm impressed once in a while. There's our final little, it's like an ice cream cone, doesn't it? Yeah, a little vanilla frosted, yeah. Well, that's basically one full day, an absolutely full day of work to get that piece.
Just under 9 grams. That's hard to believe. That is about, just over a quarter of an ounce. And when that's finally installed, I haven't been more happy getting to sleep. What a long day. Anyway, one day cell done, one to go. Hopefully we'll get some of that done tomorrow.
Chickie really loves when we're carving, because those little pieces of wood, that shavings and things that wind up on the floor and everywhere. And of course, when he's done with that, he just eats the telephone. He's eaten two telephones on me already. The way this month worked out, we have the warmest weather we've ever had this time of year. It's actually been almost flying. I would say almost. It really is flying weather. And Tom is going to try to get here Saturday. Maybe we can get up the field with the jet. He's got an OS Max. And we have a 72 to break in for Woody Midgley. Now Woody Midgley is going to put this 72 in his the plane that has the carbon fiber wing, so that'll really give us another little project to test. First thing I try to do every morning is clear all the molds, prep them, and get all the molds laid up so that they can all be drying while I'm working on the projects like the B-25. And today I want to look at getting some more data in our database for the cowlings. Just turns out that this part was about 60 grams. This one was 29. So you can see we've already got the weight in half. And we haven't pulled the part out of today's mold. This one certainly is, we're never going to be any worse than this. But if we can get it down under 29, we'll really be looking good.
Every morning, when I pull this mold apart, what I'm trying to do with each part is get the parts as light as possible and yet still that they'll be strong enough. And it certainly looks like this is going to be a serviceable mold. Usually by now I can tell if the parts are coming out the way I expect. Now this one I made up just a little bit different. I made this up with the material that I use on the carbon fiber tanks just to see if that would be a doable thing. Or if I could get the weight down under 29. Because once I decide how much material and what matrix of material and resin and what that's going to be, what that allows me to do, then I'll just produce a few of them. Now I can see this is going to be difficult. See, because it's very thin wall. When it gets thin wall, it gets difficult to get out without cracking it. In the beginning, when I was first learning how to do this, I would break a lot of parts getting them out of the mold because I got anxious. Then I learned you just got to keep doing this loosening routine. Now this one might be too flimsy. But again, you never know this. This is what it's like Tom developing those engines. You just have to keep fooling with them until you get it right. And by the way, that Brodak engine is done and ready for production. The last day we had out with that, it was a killer. And that's going to be available very soon. We'll have it up on a website. Obviously, John will have them for sale. I'll have them for sale. There we go. Just need some patience. And that's the part I'm trying to make. Well, let's see what it weighs. We have a spot here, but then we could use this to cut the hole for the head. Let's just get a feel for this.
Now see this one, even though this one has some flaws in it, this one we got it down to 26. What I'm guessing is anything less than an ounce. What happens is too much of a trade-off here. This really is getting a little flimsy. So what that allows me to do now is I go back to the one that I thought was the best of the bunch, which was this one. And this one was about an ounce. And I'll replicate the material, and what I used is 3 ounce on this. One layer of 3 ounce, one layer of 0.5. I've got one that's too heavy, one that's about as light as I think you can make it, and one that's too light now. So I know by having the material in, I had the unidirectional material, the grain is not oriented the right way. You get these bubbles where it pulls away from the mold. What you really need is like on the tank mold to have a compression mold there if you're going to use that material. What I'll do is I'm going to make one more test part out of 4 ounce e-glass, because this really isn't a part yet that you absolutely have to have carbon fiber in, just to see if it's going to be any lighter, stronger, the same. We never can tell what until we make a part. The rest of this molding off camera. And the other thing we have to do, no point repeating it unless we find some shortcut here, is make up another one of these snow cones for the other side. And once both of them are made, we'll be ready to move on to the next step of the project, the flaps. The things I thought the rule was going to apply to this of
Every time you do the second part, it goes in half the time or a third of the time less or something. Wrong. Boy. Getting these even and making a match set out of them with all my little reverse templates is just turning out to be, it's going to be a whole nother day. There's just no other way this is going to be done. If, in fact, if I get this done today, this will be kind of a miracle. A lot of jobs, when you do them like laying up the cowlings and stuff, the second and third time, you cruise through them in a fraction of the time. But apparently that's not always the case. This is just one of these things. These have to be a match set. And I don't want to compromise any step of it, the hollowing or anything. You want to get them down to, the other one was about 10 grams, if I remember. You want to get them down that weight. But I really am a little shocked at how long this has taken. This is just one of those things that just can't explain it. Just, I guess I'm slow. Maybe I'm just getting old. This is, you're looking at right there. That's another whole day's work. Now with the two parts all hollowed out and just taped in place, just so I can see how this looks. Now, one of the things, if we were making a scale model, this fillet, because the wing would be a different shape, the airfoil, this fillet would have a slightly different contour, but this is how this laid out with the wing being thickened, so it's something that we really, not exactly scale, but we have to live with, that's for sure. Now the next thing, when I get another session of work on this, what I'm going to try to do is lay out where the flap, and it's going to be extended from the stock dimension, extend it back and make up some little prototype parts, figure out how I need to do the horn. But for right now, this was a pretty good day to look at it from a lot of different angles and just get the look. It looks like that's about as accurate as I possibly could have ever dreamed about making it. Those nacelles, easily, you could easily build a cardinal kit for each nacelle. Now in today's mail, we got a real nice set of photos here from Ken Clapson. Now Ken, you know, up in Canada there, he gets a lot of modeling time basically because it snows so much he never has to go to work. Kind of like that system myself. This is a really interesting set of pictures. I'm going to go through these. Now what he decided to do was something I'm not sure I would have taken this approach, but this is his big GB with a Sato 72. And I'm reading his note. He needs somebody to buy him a three-cylinder 90. Well, Ed Gallagher's thinking about ordering one. And, yeah, it's an expensive motor. But now picture this with a three-cylinder Sato. Anyway, what Ken has done here, and again, I'm not sure this is how I would have approached it. He's been working on this plane on and off for 5 years. He tinted the clear black. Well, I don't know. So we could find the mistakes. I don't know, Ken. You're a labor-intensive guy, but I still think silver shows up better. Just my opinion. And the other thing, he said he sanded this out, and I'm reading a very long note. It's a removable wing, 7/8 dihedral, landing gear struts. The wheels are 3.5 inches, and I hope. Ken, you said you're going to send some video of this for the first flight. This would really be great. You get that three-cylinder Sato in there and forget about it. Now he's asking the question of when he should put the Z-tron in. You can put the Z-tron in after you fly it. I intend to fly the B-25 before I even get involved in Z-tron. You don't want to be playing with the Z-tron when you're trying to trim out the plane. First you want to trim the plane out. He's got a carbon fiber fuel tank. I think that's one we made. We made him two of them, in fact. Maybe he's using one of them there. And he says this other plane, he's been working on this for quite a long time. And no matter how much Gorham's he puts on it, it still looks like a dog. He says he envies Wendy with Peeps sharing a pizza. He says this dog eats the whole pizza every time they order one. Oh! Anyway, Ken, we're going to get back to working on, the B-25, but I got to tell you, with all the time you have to do modeling up there, see, Ken has this great business. Every time it snows, he just says, well, honey, I got to go work in the shop, and he locks the door from the inside, and then he orders pizza, gets the dog going, turns the heat up. I don't know, he builds a lot more planes than I do. And he's building a little tsunami, too. Anyway, Ken, we really appreciate the pictures. I'll pass some of these on to Stunt News and see if they publish them.
I just never tire of sharing the world of stunt with my videos, with pictures, phone calls, any way we can do it. This weekend we're not going to see Mike. He's going down to Joe Adamusco's to do a construction job for him, but I'm sending some videos down to Joe. I hope he's going to enjoy watching them, and take good care of Mike. I need him. One of my favorite people, Joe Adamusco, the inventor, the person who conceived the drawing, did most of the design work, and boy was he ever a fun guy to work with and fly with, and we're going to be doing a lot of that come springtime.
Now I know Joe at one time had some drawings for a roto finish. This is the plane that ultimately became roto finish, I believe, I'm not sure. And of course ultimately later on these planes evolved, became Miss Ashley, but just thinking, here's the new Brodak Silver and the new Brodak Green, the two new colors that should be out by the end of this week, or soon. We hope we're going to have them in stock real soon. Here's the exact two colors you would need to build it.
One of my favorite colors, that Miss Ashley Red, which seems to be the color of choice for Mike Kajewski's plane. Anyway, back to the shop, back to that B-25. We have projects to work on. I'm so glad those nacelles are kind of getting to the end. We need to work on these flaps and this control system.
I got a little bit of time tonight, and what I wanted to do is, you know, from the very beginning of this project, having these angles and sweep has been a problem. And so what I've tried to do is look at, I've talked to Keith Trossel, Al Raby, and of course Dave Downey. We've all gotten universal joints, Kurt Mullinex, people that have had to deal with this in various ways. And the truth is I'm still not satisfied with any of the methods. So what I'm going to do here, and I may even get one of these made up tonight. I got a little bit of time. I want to make up a fake prototype flap just to see how far out we have to get this. See, this arm, as it's working here, is supposedly moving a given amount. Now, one of the ways you could reduce that amount is by shortening this. Well, I don't like that idea either. The boxes, and we could line them. We have some Teflon material that Dave Downey sent, and we have some tin stock that we could line it with. Paul Walker on his B-17 just used wood, and he said it didn't wear out, and we may not have to go any more complex than that. But what I want to do with the little bit of time I have, and I always like to use these little end-of-the-day things, make little prototypes up that I can get an idea of just how difficult of a problem this is going to be to work around. So the first thing I need to do is cut two hinge slots in here with my hinge slotting tool. I need to get that center line. Of course, that's why we have center lines on everything here. You can just pick up the center line, just sand right through the silver. And there's our center line. And set up two hinge pockets will be enough here. We don't have to put a finish on them either. Have our little tool that we made up for, these are for take apart hinges, which of course is what we're going to be using. And I can go right through the silver. I can just seal this with thin CA for the time being. Now after making some nice hinge slots with a cutoff wheel, there's no reasonably easy way I can figure out to put this in a jig and do it. I've got to kind of do it by hand. But I've made really sure that I had these on center because I have a center line already there. Now I'm not sure if we're going to be able to engineer this up that this section is removable the way we normally do with a wire. There's so many choices here. And this is why I need to have plenty of time to do some little testing. I have the spare flap that we have, and this is the old carbon fiber flap from Miss Ashley, which I can use now because it already has a horn insert in there.
I can cut off a piece roughly the size we're going to use because I want to measure how much movement we have of the horn arm out there. So having these used parts will just save me a little bit of time. Now what I wanted to try to calculate, but apparently this is not a practical way to calculate it, is how many degrees of sweep this changes. Now you can see what's trying to happen. This is trying to pull away instantly. So rather than do it that way, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put two fake hinge slots in here. And just put two hinge slots in here. And then I can calculate out on the arm itself how much it's moving. This is kind of a crude way to calculate this, but I'm assuming it'll work. I'm trying to look at this angle here. So I just need to know how wide I have to make the part of this that this horn is going to swivel in. It moves. At this point, it's over the tape. Let's just get this more accurate. It's on the edge of the tape. And down here, it moves a good quarter of an inch in that deflection. So I know I better make it at least 3/8 of an inch wide. And what I want to do is make up a little test box, just a box. I remember I made these boxes up just as test units. Not allowed, but this is way too wide. It's over a half inch. What I need to do is make this up. Just make some little test boxes. I also have this tape. This is the stuff that that Dave Downey sent. I wonder if this will be. I wonder if this comes off after a while with the glue or with oil soaking into it or something. Let's see. You have to put plywood underneath it, of course. Boxes I had were lined with tin. The idea is to get no slop in there whatsoever. Now, from making up those little test pieces, I can pass along one little bit of information. It looks real easy to make precision little boxes that have a precision fit over the wire, but in reality it isn't easy at all. It's difficult. Now I measured up the distance I'm going to want to have of about 2 inches here, so I'm going to cut up some pieces of wood. I need to make two of these, of course. We're going to use some 1/8-inch sea grain wood. This is some real nice stiff wood. Now I'll start off just by making one test box. But while I'm putting it together, I can lay out the parts for the second box, just in case this does not turn out to be the right dimension. Too big, too small, too wide. But to get one, it's not as easy as it looks. Using some 1/64 plywood, the plywood has two grains going in the long direction. That's the dimension we need most of the strength in. Now I kind of gave up on the idea with the tape. What I did, I took the tape, glued it to some wood, and then put some fuel by it, and it immediately started delaminating. So unless we can figure a way of bonding, that might not be an appropriate choice. But what I'm going to do is put two layers of 1/64 plywood on each side of this. Let's have two laminates of 1/64 plywood, but the next step is probably the most important one. This is the one I've been a little errant on in making my test pieces, is to get 90 degree angles on everything. Because what happens when you go to glue the edges on the boxes, if the angles aren't 90 degrees,
what happens, one side, they'll be like this. They'll wind up being not parallel. So I want to start by getting them, and I found a good little trick here in making up a couple of these test pieces. And then what I'm going to do is put this piece of label off of there. Just put them together. It gives you double a chance of getting the edges nice and straight. And it's these edges right here that we need to have totally parallel. And totally, see, these are not straight. Even though I tried to make them, I guess we could make a little jig for this, but right now I don't have to. What you could do is take a piece of wood and put a saw cut in it so that these would drop in and you could dress these off. But this will be accurate enough for now, I think. Every time I say that, it winds up not being accurate enough, so. Okay, they're both parallel. Now, I tried to come up with a way, a poor man's way, so to speak, of holding these exactly the dimension apart while I glue the sides on. And the sides are going to have 1/64 plywood with the grain going straight up and down. Make up this little fixture. I want to take some CA and just coat this just a little bit to fuel-proof it first, or fuel-proofing it, because once this part is put away, we really can't get in there conveniently. And that's what I was afraid of with the tape, is the tape would get in, start boiling up, jam the controls, and I'd not be able to conveniently get it out. Now this just hardens it up just ever so slightly. And fuel-proof it just a little bit too. You can see what I've got is a little, I don't know if you call it a fixture or jig, but that's the amount of space we need precision. I figure there's nothing going to be more precision than the wire itself. And this accounts for any variation. Now I just got to make sure, I'm going to cut 1/64 plywood and glue one side at a time, and make sure they're both 90 degrees. Now you really would think that making these little boxes would be a snap. Found it to be, because you need them to be real precision. They just can't be sloppy. And I thought I'd come up with some little way. Actually, if I knew I was going to do this over and over again, I'd make a real little jig out of an aluminum block or something. But for right now, I think this is going to get us through. And if this works, then we'll make them up. We need four of these all together. Now, before I glue the other side on, I want to make sure it's 90 degrees. That's the critical thing here. I glued that other part on. I want to make sure, and I can look pretty much from this angle. Now I can put the pieces back in and glue the other side on. And that's the ultimate poor man's little fixture. Anytime you can do some little modeling thing with a real low budget, now see, you could also do this a million different ways. I'm sure there are other little scenarios how to work it. But as long as you can do it within the budget that you have for your modeling. And when it kicks off. Get rid of the jig for now. And we can go over to the belt sander and just true these up. Makes me crazy. A lot of times, the simplest little part, like these boxes, I can absorb such a big amount of time. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to soak all the exposed areas with thin CA because I want these to be fuel proof no matter what. And I thought this was going to be, obviously we're going to have to taper this down even with the flap. And as much as that horn is going to move in there,
I think that's about as precision of a fit. I don't want any slop in there.
Anyway, one little part, amazing. Now I just need to make up another one for the other side. And then I can run, well, I can go over and just look and see how they're going to work on the plane itself.
The key thing when they're in place, there's no slop at all in them. Because if these get sloppy from that thing wearing in, well, I'm not sure how we could deal with that. I was a little, I'm still hesitant because I hope someday we'll come upon something that will be a better system than this. This just doesn't reek of the kind of thing I would like. But on the other hand, it's the devil I know. And a lot of times when you get caught up in stuff that's too high tech, the devil you know is a better choice. A lot of times you just get too cute. Now, I need to just lay out a piece of scrap wood, lay out a flap here, tack this on, and see how to just make a dummy. I guess a dummy flap would be the best word. Just tack glue on to see that there's no binding here or anything before I make up the flaps. I probably won't get to do the flaps today, but I'll get the little test done and then I can think about it tonight. We just have this tack glued in place. Of course, it's our box. When it's a real flap, this will be notched in. And we'll be using a thicker piece of wood. This is just a test. I wanted to see, if anything, if there was any binding there. Is that, see how that piece moves back and forth? Now it's up against the edge in full down. So I need to take that into account. When it's in full down, it's as far over that way as it's going to go. And as it goes in up, see, actually now I don't even need to make these boxes this large, this wide. Could make them half of this width. Yeah, from looking at how that's moving, I could probably cut these right in half. In fact, I'm going to do that. I'm going to cut this down some, or when I make the next set, I have to make a set for the outside. I can certainly make them a lot thinner than that. That piece all the way over. In the full down, it's all the way out. In full up, it moves out that way. That's got a relatively nice fit there. So that's good to know, and that's why tonight I wanted to make a little test. I'm going to end this night with my little test, at least knowing that we have flaps on the plane now. When we come back tomorrow, we're going to figure out more of the intricacies of this little situation here. But I feel good knowing that this got done today and that we have at least a feel for how we're going to make these boxes up. Now this morning, I was hoping, come on, well, you turn the camera on and nothing goes right. We now have, let's see, we got four, this is the fourth one, and it looks like we finally have a good combination of materials, thicknesses, and weights. This looks like the best one yet. So basically what I'll do it off camera, of course, is just repeat this into another part, because I want to get a couple extra of these. When I start cutting them up, I want to have ones for the four strokes. I want to have ones for each engine combination, unless some of them interchange. But so far, I'd rate that as decent enough success. And each one we're doing is just getting just a little bit better. We're going to try to get these down to under an ounce. And this last one is another gram or two lighter each time. They're just getting a little bit better.
Now today, the day has come to see if we're going to get these flaps working at least the way I wanted to. First thing I wanted to do, and this is all going to be little test pieces, I cut those boxes in half, so I have double the amount of boxes to cut this bird in half. Anyway, the first thing I need to do is make up a little test piece here to see, because I don't know. See, I try to work on this one first. I really ought to put both of these on and try to estimate to see that we have exactly the same size on both sides. That was important. Now I made up just a test piece to see if I could flip from side to side and see how big I needed to make this piece. Because this is going to be 4.5 inches, I'm going to have to add a piece. And one thing good, I do have some really nice, really decent quarter grain, quarter inch wood to work with here. But the first thing is I need to lay out the pattern that I'm going to be using. The most important thing here, and I need them to be exactly even. That's the main thing right now. Because I don't want one side to be any bigger than the other side. It'll make an asymmetrical aerodynamic problem. So I want to be real careful when I work this out that I'm not creating a situation where one flap is a little longer or wider. I want them to be exact mirror images of each other. This I know, and this is just a piece of scrap, I know I need to go 0.7 in this dimension, 0.5, I have the little area for the box we're going to insert, and I know this angle I need to line up right with the edge of the fuselage. This I laid out the full size piece, and you can see because it's 4.5 inches I have to tack on a little piece out at the tip. Now where the join is, I want to make sure I have all true edges. And as I'm making these parts, I want to make sure that, again, one of the most important things is to have exact mirror images where one isn't just a little stiffer. I'm making them from exactly the same piece of wood, in fact. Now I need to figure out where I'm going to cut this piece of wood. I need to tack on just a little piece here. What I've done is, you can take a piece of quarter grain wood and feel how stiff it is, go out to, and one side is usually stiffer than the other. Well, obviously I'm making it from the stiffest piece I can. And there's several parts on a plane that I think absolutely no way do I want the lightest pieces of wood, I want the stiffest. And certainly the flaps are one of them. Now a lot of times you get, I call it, get suckered into using up some super light piece of wood that's A grain, it isn't C grain. And when you're all done, and you go to fly the plane, yeah, it's a gram or two lighter. And in this case, I know we're going to pay a little bit of a weight penalty here, because this is not really the lightest pieces of wood. But these are by far the stiffest that I have. Now I want to get this nice and flat. We just got to cut this out and then check that it fits in between the nacelle and where the fuselage will be with plenty of clearance. Next thing I want to do is get a center line on everything, true the edges up. I have the fit that I'm looking for now. Amazing. If we ever could find two pens in the world at right. I want to get a center line. If there's one really lesson, I mean it's really important that I think is, if you're going to make solid wood flaps, quarter grain wood is worth whatever you have to, price you have to pay in terms of, they stay straight, they don't warp up as soon as you put dope and tissue on them. Well worth the little extra effort. Okay, now we got a center line on our roughed out flap. I want to get a nice little radius on the front before I put the hinge pockets in. Now, of course, I can just go over to the wing and marry up the hinge pockets. Just marked where I'm looking at this clearance here first. We'll move that a little closer. See, what happens is if you were just doing a top view, you could get this way over. But then as soon as you lower the flap, the nacelle is bigger below the wing, and it runs into the nacelle. So I need to lower the nacelle as far as it'll go, and then set the clearance, which looks like this will be it right here. To adjust this a little bit. And before I do anything else, I want to get the hinge pockets in here so I can have this in place, and then I'll lay out the box where we're going to put that little box on the wing. These little recesses that we use, just have my little tool that puts that exact little recess in there. Now I can lay out where I want to have the cutout for the little box. I have the little impression of where the horn resided. I have the little box. By the way, I cut these, and I mentioned that I cut them in half. So in essence, I've made all four of them in one stroke of the pen. It sounds like I invented that along the way, but I didn't. Believe me, it was just an accident. Now I can trace this piece out. Cut that piece out. Now this is, here's that little piece. I have the little recess for the horn. Now I need to glue this exactly on center line. Because you can picture what would happen if you glue this one way or the other and it's not exactly on center. So what I'll do first is tack glue it with a couple of drops. Get it set. Pre-glue this end so I'm getting a real good bond into that end grain wood. Once I have that tack glued in place and I'm happy that it's right on center, I get a permanent joint on this. Now this is just roughly in place. You can see I've got, looks like the right amount of clearance there. I've got fuselage clearance here. Now remember, one of the things we're trying to accomplish here is to make the flaps bigger than they normally would be by a percentage, and of course this is all a matter of guesswork, and move them less. So we'll be using a 4-to-5 ratio. In other words, the flaps will move 4 degrees every time the elevators move 5. We also have the option of moving them 3-to-2. Now, one of the little tricky jobs, you can't miss this by much because we only have a 1/64 of an inch extra here of this, what amounts to be filler balsa. So this is one of the things I try to do as carefully as I can. The best thing is just go real slow. Because what we're looking to do is bury that box down in the woods. The best thing is at the end, when it's down, we started out quite a bit up, that last little bit,
I don't want to touch this part. I want to come at it with a little bit of an angle this way. Just repeat the same thing on the other side.
All sanded in nicely, and that really does blend right in. One of the things I want to do is harden the wood, even though this is relatively hard wood. This is not 3-pound wood, that's for sure. Soaking it with thin CA will harden it up even a little more, a little extra, a little cheap insurance. And what we need to do is get a little bit of an airfoil shape in it. Just taper it back just a little bit. Now I remember Les McDonald writing in the magazine, and of course that goes back a long time, so my memory may not be that good, that he had tried or tested thin flaps versus thick flaps, and what he found made the most lift. And I think Al Raby did the same test. Thin flat flaps. I have to go back and reread that. I have a copy of it here. As long as you use big, wide sanding blocks, that in essence should come out. It should make that part disappear right into the quarter-inch wood. Now we also, what I'll do the next step here is I'll make up the other flap just so I can put them both on at the same time and see if they will look and or work the way I expect. Now I just need to, with a large long blade, taper some of this back so this comes to a little bit of a point. I taper this a whole lot. So I don't want to lose the effect of having a flat flap. I don't want it to come to a paper-thin point either, because this little flap is going to be transmitting all the torque out to the other eighth-inch horn that we haven't made yet, and then into the other flap. And I looked at a lot of different ways of putting that third little flap in, and I haven't found one that I'm happy with yet. So unless I invent something in the next hour or so, or while I'm making up the other flap, what I'm going to go with is just having the two flaps interconnected and that little piece, which is only about a little over an inch, having that just glued in as a fillet or somehow improvised there. Now, as soon as I'm finished with this, I'll just make the opposite side flap. Now the other one will go a little bit quicker because we already have an exact pattern and we could just cut it right in. We can make a mirror image of this and then fit it in rather than having to lay out all the dimensions and angles and everything. And what we'll probably do is when we're all done and the plane is in one piece, figure out where we want to put an edge, how close. I'd like to get this close to the fuselage just so it kind of aerodynamically traps a little more air there. These are just roughed out. I'm going to do it with fine sandpaper when I'm real happy with the final shape. Now with one, I'll make the other one up off camera. Now with the both flaps made, this is kind of neat looking the way it rises and shuts. Now, the next thing I have to figure out how I want to
how I want to do it. See, I had to leave a lot of clean. As that goes down, it runs right into the nacelle. And I made sure that they're exact mirror images. They're not even out by thousands. Exact. So that, and there's no binding here. So this I feel like, and it's real solid. So maybe that is going to be successful. I just don't know it. What I need to do is figure out how I want to make a horn that connects here to right here is where the ring joins. And then I need to make, see, there normally would be that little flap in here, but that flap is only going to be an inch wide. It's going to look, I think it's going to look ridiculous flapping up and down here when the flaps are this big. Maybe if they were to scale size, it wouldn't matter. So what I'm going to do is lay out a piece of 1/8 inch wire with the horn here, and then try to attach it with two little bushing areas. Maybe I can get the bushing underneath here. That's the next thing I have to look at, how I want to actually do it. Of course, this wing has a little bit of an angle in it. It's an optical illusion that the flaps are moving in one dimension more than the other. And what I wanted to do is I want to find exact neutral. Because remember, once I find exact neutral here, I need to bend the horn before I even make the horn so that it's neutral at the tip. So I thought one way of doing that is I cut up the extra set of drawings that Dave had sent. And I have a big piece of scrap wood here. And what I'm going to do is contact cement this right onto the wood. Let's see if it's wide enough. Yes, it is. And then I'll have a template that I can slide up onto the fuselage, hopefully to establish my neutral and see if this is going to be a practical way of doing it. And if it isn't, we'll look at another way. So just contact cement this down to a scrap piece. See if this is going to work. Now this looks like, you know, we could of course put the wing in the fuselage every time we want to find neutral, but I think this will be a lot easier. And that gives us an idea where, right off of Dave's drawing, right where neutral is going to be. So that, now that I can set neutral, that just gives me a neutral, because again, I can set neutral out here by the tip. This flap needs to be in neutral at the same time that one is, with all these cantilevered angles. And if you don't think this is getting complicated, getting crazy, but without this, what fun would a project like this be? I mean, if you're going to build Noblers or Cardinals or something forever, yeah, that's cool too, but this is really challenging to get all these areas all in neutral at the same time, get these boxes to where I'm hoping I'm going to be happy with them. Let's not count our chickens here. Now I can take this piece off, just get the tape off, and I could lay out my 1/8 inch wire here, make up a dummy horn, because we have to come out to, here's the joint in the ring, right to about here. Well, I have to see how this is going to relate to that box. Gets tricky, but one by one, we're solving the problems that at one time were looking like they might be insurmountable.
Now, I put that orange on there so I could get an idea of just exactly how I can keep track of them, and I also can check for if I want to tweak a flap, anything like that. But for right now, that's the best shot we got.
Now I feel more comfortable laying out this wire horn.
Just a mock-up piece of wire to see where that's going to wind up. I inserted a little aluminum tube there just to hold it. Haven't made the confining little pieces here yet, because the next thing I want to do is make the flap out here so that I can see that this is all going to be working the way I want before I attach this. So the next step here is to make this outer piece of the flap. Now the next step, I got this real, really nice piece of sea grain. Boy, I'm going to try to get both flaps out of it, but I don't know if I will. If I needed to estimate that, because we have a new angle here,
and get it to line up right with the trailing edge. I have the little bushings. This is all just temporarily installed so I can get that last piece hinged and then see how everything works in unison before I glue that in.
Now it looks like, look at how lucky we are. We're going to get both of these, and this is the best piece of sea grain I have right here. I didn't want to waste this. The other advantage of this is they'll both be hopefully be equal. You're going to have one real stiff flap and one real weak one. But every once in a while you do luck out. This was one of the times.
Put that little radius on the front edge, and I laid out exactly where the horn rotated out and back. So that, now I have to have this amount of clearance in my, when I put that little box on. I left a little piece here that I'll trim off later. Next thing I have to do is lay out some hinge pockets here. Now with the hinge pockets cut in here, I want to center line it. As soon as I cut the hinge pockets, then I need to transpose these notches, of course, out into the other side. These are our half pockets, I'll call them, for lack of a better word, because I want this actually to be hinged in place when I set up that box. Now I just take just enough of the silver off that I can see the center line where the hinge pockets will go. I can see the center line now. Now you just run my tool in there and then slit it for the hinges. It's very nice being able to just go down and get that center line anytime I need it.
Is to cut the notch out for this box and then get it centered completely in there.
This to be a really nice snug fit in here. I don't know, maybe we're going to cut this whole thing off. I don't know. And I could always add a piece, because how the fillets are going to wind up on this is going to be determined by where these flaps actually move when they all start interacting with the nacelles and the fuselage sides. And now, as always, when I'm going to go around anything end grain, I want to build up a couple layers of thin CA on here. Just gets a good penetration. Oop, there we go, right down. Penetration into your shirt. Just let that kick off and be ready to line up our part. I always like to do this too, just wipe it with a quick Q-tip. Yeah, it's going to be a nice tight fit. Whoop! Once that's in there nice, I want to get a good soaking of CA in there. The CA hardens up the wood, it spreads the footprint out just a little bit too. As soon as that kicks, then I'll grind this off. There we go.
Before I go any further, I wanted to make sure I have this center line, and I know this is on center on the wing. It would also go into an imaginary point. I don't know how to check that. I have no idea. There's an imaginary point where these two lines would meet. I can't really figure where that is right now. Now I'm looking at, I don't know how we're going to do this. That's yet to be figured out. And before I carve and sand this whole flap down, I just wanted to tape everything in position. Make sure everything was moving the way I anticipated. This is the first time I've seen all three of the flaps move at the same time. It's relatively nice and smooth, to tell you the truth. It's not bad at all. So the next thing is I'm going to carve that little bit of an airfoil in here, flatten this block out, flat down with this, and I don't know. This little piece here, after this is all glued in and finalized, maybe I can get a piece on it. I don't know yet. That's what makes this so exciting is, I don't know if exciting is the right word. Some people would find this not fun at all. They would find it to be annoying. Well, I find that reward of when it's all done and I have all these things moving consecutive. I think it's going to be just
just very, very nice looking. It's going to be very realistic looking. So you're not used to seeing flaps that are all canted and cantilevered and everything.
But I'm not going to make anything permanent here. Glue anything in or do it, and I'm not even going to glue that piece of wire in that I call a horn, but it isn't. Because what I want to do, I want to have the whole system in place all at one time. I'll make the other flap off camera. I want to have everything and then look for that center line going right around the whole perimeter and watch that they all come up and they all drop down against my gauge here. And when this lines up with this, something about this, it just really looks cool with all these flaps moving up and down. Been sitting there just looking at them. Now, the thing Dave Downey was not sure of, and of course none of us are, in fact, we're going to find out the hard way, is because we've lost all this wing area. This is wing area that's not really airfoiled, but it does have a little bit of a curve, and maybe it will make some lift. I'm not sure. I noticed the nacelles are kind of airfoiled. Maybe in a real B-25, they try to use that to their advantage. I don't know. I wish I knew some of these things. But anyway, this, when you see this in real life with all the flaps moving up and down, it looks like a 747 or something. Basically doing, I'll do it off camera. This is the same as sanding that in, sanding the box in, replicating the whole flap out on, making a mirror image of it out there, checking with a ruler to make sure we have a perfectly straight line here. But everything will be removable until I have the whole thing laid out and I can lay it on a bench and get that center line. The most important single thing is that they all come back to neutral at exactly the same time. Well, unfortunately tonight we had some company come over unexpectedly and I didn't get to finish the outer flap. That'll be a separate little session. But this part of it, I think, is as good as we can get it with the Devil You Know system. I think the wing still has the look of the B-25, even with the extended flaps. Once we get both of the nacelles on, there's about one more session of work here. I'm going to try to get back down early tomorrow morning and work on this. Because what happens, you get to this point, and you want to see it finished. Not finished, but I want to see it in one piece. I want to see it with the body in place, and then start to fine-tune the cowling fits. Well, I said this before, a plane like this is, in my estimation, about like doing six normal ships. Every single part of the plane has to be thought out, and the time you think about it even counts. Without some real great cooperation and teamwork from the people that have helped me along the way, Bob Zambelli and Dave Downey, Joe Adamusco, all the people that have contributed emotional support to this, and even Ron Merrill has been real nice about being enthusiastic about the program. But anyway, it's too late now. And another thing too is, when it gets late like this, a lot of times you don't do your best work. So we're going to have that big cup of coffee in the morning. I'm going to get done. And I heard something really interesting too. I was talking to Tom Hampshire the other day. He does this thing where he gets up real early in the morning and works on his model for an hour uninterrupted. Well, it'd be nice if we could stop the phone from ringing for a couple of hours, but we got to do what we got to do. Real soon, I hope within the next couple of days, we're going to get a sample of this Brodak silver so I can shoot some parts. That's another thing that's coming, I hope, real soon. Now, today, this will pretty much be pretty much a copy of what we did yesterday, so there's no point unless I come up with some miracle way of dealing with this. What I did the other night, I was down here and I recorded the movie Catch-22 that has, I've been watching it over and over, I put it on every day now when I come to the shop. It's just loaded with B-25 footage. And there's a lot of, I didn't know they had this many B-25s in the whole world. But the point is, while I'm going to spend the day here making a flap or making an elevator or whatever, boy, if you're going to have a movie in your library, that's a good one. And it's always on TV. You can always pull it right off. I pulled it off regular TV the other night. I don't even want to think about how long it took to do this.
Could have made seven cardinals. Anyway, this is what the final thing is, and I found another little quirk that's going to be a problem, is when I want to take this centerpiece on and off, I have to have a little bit of play in a wire so I can slide it back and slide it forward. It doesn't slide right on. But we've got all the flaps. They all check out at 0-0 with the gauges. Everything looks level, even when you look at it from this angle. Now the last thing is I have to figure out this little detail here. In fact, I'll glue that on next. I'm just going to put some 5-minute epoxy, a couple of drops on each one, because what I have to be able to do is take it off. And to slide it off, it has to be that I'm not compressing it. You have to be able to slide this wire. It's hard to explain this. I need to be able to slide this wire in and out about a 1/64 of an inch. Looks like I can do that. Okay.
One of the things I could have done, of course, is get this angle out to 90. I don't want to try bending a horn once it's all installed. The mistake I made was making this 90 instead of 90 to the trailing edge. So what happens is I have one that's 90 to the trailing edge, one that isn't, and this clearance just fits in there, just by. But what I need to be able to do is just be able to move this just 1/64 of an inch when I want to take the control surfaces on and off. So I'm going to epoxy that in. That's the next thing. Epoxy that in and then see that I can get everything on and off without a problem. Now what I did, I guess the word is temporarily, put a few drops of 5-minute epoxy in there, because if I have to rip this out, I don't want that to be a permanent joint. But what I'm going to do is, you can get them on and off, but as you get them on and off, this wire has to move back and forth. So it presents just one more complexity into it. That's something we can't deal with. And since we intend to make these surfaces removable, we want to be able to remove them. That's for sure. That's one of the prime things of removable surfaces, being able to remove them. As soon as this dries, and I'll let that 5-minute dry, then I'm going to make sure I can get them on and off without a problem. And of course that it hasn't altered anything in this plane, and I'll recheck that everything's back at zero. There's just no part of this plane that's easy. There just isn't a single thing that you say, oh, well, we'll just... And when I think of just making a set, this is a set of flaps, there's four sets of flaps on a plane. There's not only two of some things, there's four and whatever. But anyway, I don't want to sound like I'm cranky or anything. When this is all done, and Kenny Clapson had the best thing always, is the first time you walk out to the middle of the circle and the helper releases the plane, you'll really be disappointed. Anyway, once this kicks off, then we're going to check all off-fits again. That's the next step. Now, unfortunately, you know, this is supposed to be a real nice weekend. The temperatures have been in the 60s. Only one problem is Craig, of course. Our son is moving, and we've kind of volunteered the whole weekend away for him, but he's worth it. And the weekend after that, I'm hoping, if the weather holds up the way it is, we'll get a flight on this guy, preliminary flight, and see if the wing shows any promise. We're going to continue making cowls until we get a pair that we're really happy with. Hope Tom's going to get to fly the jet this weekend. Well, I'll tell you, this is... When you hold this in your hand, you don't even want to run it. Oh, there's something about it. Now we're almost at the end of the tape, and I always, at the end of the tape, try to summarize what we've gotten done and what we're going to try to do. In the next tape, we're going to try to set up the cowls, set up the motors. In fact, we have both of the motors, both big carb and small carb versions of the Webers. We're going to set that up as our initial test motor. Only because that's a motor that's got several years of flying and development on it, and that'll become our square one package. And once I get all this gluing and get all these
I'm just looking to put that aside. When I go to bed tonight, just lay it on the floor or hang it up. I'll sleep like a baby tonight.
Now we have to get this right after this all dried up. This slides on, even though these angles are different. Basically because of that slot. But I realized another thing that I didn't realize before. I really only need one hinge in the middle because this can't go anywhere. This is set in bushings. Could have gotten away with one hinge, maybe saved a weight of one hinge. Well, anyway, this worked out well. I'm totally satisfied the way that worked out. Now, I don't know actually in service when this wears a little bit if it'll be a problem, but the thing is I can get at, if this does wear, I can grind out this edge and put brass shim stock or something in there. So it looks like it's the devil we know. Not sure we love him, but at least we know him. Well, like it or not, we got all the hinges in, all the little wires. Next time we get to work on this, we're going to glue the back of the nacelles on. One of the things I want to do, I want to get in here and gut out some of those formers. That the nacelle construction is unbelievably strong. Planking is, because it's all round, it has no flat sides. Very strong. I think I can get in there and gut out some of the formers. Again, I'll do that very judiciously. But we finally did get that up to this point, and this is another watershed. Once those little backs are on the nacelles, that'll just be beautiful, and then it'll really start to have that B25 look. And then I need to decide or figure out exactly how, if any, we're going to have fillets on this, because again, that part is just something that's always better to think about overnight, that's for sure. Anyway, thanks for joining us, and hope you're enjoying the tapes. Share them with everybody. Hope you're enjoying this B25 project as much as I am. And we'll see you on the next tape. And I gotta tell you, I have now watched Catch 22 about 14 times. I am so sick of hearing Yossarian's name. But again, that becomes part of the B-25, the adventure that, if you know where you're going, it sure can't be much of an adventure. And I hope on the next tape we're going to get enough progress made that we can lay this out on a floor in one piece and for the first time get an overall look at it. And thanks a lot to Bruce Hunt for sending us a lot of enjoyable things over the years. But another tape I've watched over and over, his museum tape, some B-25 footage on it. Just, can you imagine building without a VCR somewhere right by your bench? I don't know. It would be very difficult for me to do that. Really do enjoy this. And we have a special treat. Andy Lee sent me a CD that runs 45 minutes and has all of the old pictures. I hope there's some old pictures of me there when we were kids. Andy Lee, of course, is my age. And the only thing I have to do is figure out how to play the CD without turning my computer into an atomic bomb. Anyway, we'll look to try to get some of that on the tape in the near future. As we always end up every night, we always end up just thinking just how lucky we are to have the friends we have and the life we have and live in a time that has been good to us all. See you on the next tape.